Okay, well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jason Farley. I direct the Center for Infectious Disease and Nursing Innovation, which I'll tell you a little bit more about in just a second. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to the second in our inaugural startup launch of the center presentations. Today, I'll be presenting viruses, variants, and very challenging time. And the point of today's lecture is really to provide us all with a status update at the beginning of year three of this pandemic. Let me begin sharing the slides here. And just for those who I've not met and I don't know, I am an endowed professor of nursing leadership and innovation and a nurse practitioner in the Division of Infectious Disease at the John Bartlett Infectious Disease Specialty Clinic. And so in our discussion today, I really want to center us around the work, a little bit of what we do at our center. The Center for Infectious Disease and Nursing Innovation. You will see much more coming into your inbox about this particular center. It's recently launched and our website is about to go live. But our center, our mission of our center is to cultivate scientific and programmatic infectious disease expertise within nursing, whose voice has often been missing throughout this pandemic. We have center-affiliated scientists, trainees, and staff who work on designing and testing innovative, high-quality, patient-centered models of care to improve clinical outcomes for people with infectious diseases. And we have this important vision, and that is to create quality, accessible care that is free of judgment, discrimination, and inequity for persons at risk or living with an infectious disease. So I hope if this space interests you, that you can reach out to me or one of my team members and we can get you engaged in center activities. But today's focus is really to think about year three of the pandemic. We'll summarize our current understanding of the clinical features of the Omicron variant of SARS-CoV-2. We'll differentiate some of the epidemiologic and clinical features of the variant and describe and consider what our new normal will look like in 2022 and quite frankly beyond. So I wanted to begin by really broaching the subject of genome sequencing and understanding why we see so many variants emerging and just kind of juxtapose this with our HIV genome and how we use that clinically. So for those of you who might not be familiar, obviously HIV was first discovered in the United States in 1981. We know that cases existed well beyond the early 80s, cases as identified as early as the 1950s and 60s. But the time from that earliest identification to full genome sequencing was actually from 1981 to 2009. And it was really that 2009 that we really got to apply our knowledge in its fullest extent of how we might be able to apply the changes, the mutations, the variants of HIV into its clinical management. Now, in terms of genome sequencing for SARS-CoV-2 or COVID-19, it took 8 days before we had a full genome. And really, our ability to monitor and do molecular surveillance has been one of the hallmarks of the pandemic thus far. We've been able to sequence the virus, make sure that we understand how it's mutating, how it's changing, and how those changes have influenced a variety of our epidemiologic and clinical markers. And what you can see down below at the bottom of this slide is the genome as represented in this cartoon and kind of that middle section there, that's that spike protein area of the genome. And that's where we focused most of our vaccine efforts. And so when you hear a lot about changes and mutations, we're really often talking about changes or alterations and mutations in that genome, in that area of the genome for SARS-CoV-2. And it has a huge impact on the clinical treatments that we have, as well as our vaccine efficacy. And we will review some of that throughout this talk. I wanted to really describe for you the naming of these variants so that we demystify how this approach is occurring. So this is a great schematic put together by Al Jazeera, the news media outlet. And what they've identified in the brighter orange is variants that the WHO has identified as variants of concern. And in the lighter kind of orange, variants of interest. And what you can see is as variants have come out, they've been named by Greek alphabet. And you can see below each of their countries of origin, as well as the date and timing. So in September of 2020 in the United Kingdom is where we came out with the alpha variant. Again, different than wild type virus, the initial COVID-19 virus, but the alpha variant in September of 2020. We've then in May of 2020, beta, November of 2020, gamma, and then the infamous Delta in October of 2020, originating in India. And importantly, maybe ask everyone to mute if you don't mind. Thank you. In thinking about the other series of variants of interest that have emerged, we've had a variety. You can see here 7, 8, 9 on your screen in that light or orange that have not caused significant concern, but they have been of interest. And some molecular sequencing has been identifying these variants. Then we get to Nu and Z, or Chi, depending on pronunciation. And the WHO decided to skip these because of naming convention. They thought to call Omicron the Nu variant was too confusing for the public. And then they skipped Chi as a result of it being a common Asian surname, and did not want to add to any additional discrimination that the Asian community was experiencing because of this virus. And so that's how we landed really on Omicron. And we'll continue to go through this alphabet as new variants emerge. Many of you have probably already heard of the variant IHU, which is a variant discovered in France, and we'll talk more about that. It is not on this list, nor is it following the classic convention yet of this variant naming system by the WHO. And we can talk about that in a couple of slides. So why do we care so much about the variants? Well, we follow a variety of epidemiologic principles. First is, do variants lead to changes in transmission? And so what we know based on looking at our wild type virus moving into alpha, beta, and so on and so forth, is that, you know, transmission and transmissibility and the R naught, or the number of people each individual then transmits the virus onto, has been changing over time. And with Delta, we saw the cartoon that's represented here, that a first case of an individual infects about 5, possibly up to 6 additional people, and that they go on to infect 5 to 6 more. Now, right now, the R naught of the Omicron variant is still to be determined. And you've seen the news media really describing it as, quote, as infectious as measles, which would mean that it's from an R naught of 5, which is what you see represented here, it would be potentially an R naught of up to 16 to 18. So for every one individual a person infects, they can infect 16 to 18 others. And yet we've seen estimates throughout the news media that are quite frankly not always based in the most scientific literature and our approaches. We don't actually know the true R naught at this point. It's all conjecture. But you know, it is a highly transmissible virus, much more than Delta. And we can see that in the slide presentations that I'll give of the epi, at least here from the United States. So we follow variants first and foremost to see how it impacts transmissibility. Second is clinical presentation. Does it make it the virus more virulent or less virulent? And what you can see here is the hallmark clinical signs of COVID-19 in general. And I've highlighted in red for you the ones that seem to be more closely associated with the Omicron variant. Now, importantly, two hallmark symptoms, the shortness of breath and loss of taste and smell, are less prevalent with this variant. And whether or not that is a combination of the actual variant being less virulent and less likely to cause significant pathogenesis, less likely to involve the lung, or not, versus we've got a large percent of various populations who are immunized against COVID-19 is a matter of scientific debate. But in all the patients that I've diagnosed with COVID-19 over the last couple of weeks, I will tell you that those symptoms listed in red here are the typical hallmark signs. Most of my patients are describing that upper respiratory, runny nose, sore throat kind of mindset. Obviously, we've got co-circulating viruses of influenza as well. So it also picks up the potential for influenza or RSV virus as well. But a couple of things have been new that weren't as common with Delta variant or other variants with Omicron. And that includes nausea or vomiting, as well as patients reporting diarrhea. The decrease in frequency of shortness of breath or loss of taste or smell, although I still continue to see loss of taste or smell and shortness of breath and cough, as well as fevers in my patients with Omicron. It's a little less frequent. So those are all good things. In the majority of patients that I'm seeing right now, however, my symptom evaluation is a little unclear because the majority of patients that I'm speaking with today are vaccinated. So whether or not these are true Omicron symptoms in an unvaccinated population or not is something that my clinical experience, at least amongst patients here in Maryland and in Baltimore, has been limited on. We know certainly, we've heard lots of information about this, and this is one schematic, and I'll show you a lot more data in the presentation about vaccine efficacy and how Omicron as a variant has impacted. And what you can see from this diagram is that Delta, the efficacy of the Delta variant in the weeks after the vaccine has been completed. And you can see that with Delta initially in 10 to 14 weeks, it was around 80%. And you can see that fall precipitously to down around 45% around 10 to 14 weeks and continue to decline the greater number of weeks from the second dose of vaccine. You can see that with boosting on this, it's a dramatic increase in both Omicron and Delta, the ability to provide protection against severe illness increases dramatically with boosting. What we've now got additional data that I'll present later in the talk about the length of impact of the booster dose. And then finally, how do the variants impact treatment options? Of this list of treatment options that you see to your right here, you'll notice that there's only one monoclonal antibody listed, sotrovimab. And that's because the other two FDA-approved monoclonal antibodies for COVID-19 are no longer efficacious against the Omicron variant. And so certainly our treatment choices have narrowed in terms of our monoclonal antibodies, but we luckily have a couple of additional drugs that have now been approved over the last 5 to 6 months and are really providing us some level of additional armamentarium as we begin to respond to the various variants. So here's what we know in terms of transmissibility. And I show you this data. And if you've not been exploring our world in data, please take a chance to Google that, take a look at our world in data, and you can search by country. And I really thought this was the most dramatic representation that I could offer you of what we've all been and lived through this January 2020 peaks and valleys in COVID-19 infection. We've been in that November and February of 2021 period where we thought, wow, these cases could not be higher. And now look at January of 2022. Record upon record upon record, not only from the total number of cases, the total number of people being tested, the total number of people needing hospitalization. So we clearly see a magnitude of effect here in transmissibility. So the R-naught of COVID-19 is definitely higher than Delta. What it will ultimately wind up being is to be determined, but this data is clear and you can see the same pattern across the world. And so right now, as of 2 days ago, I think is when I pulled this number, January 8th, there were 59 million total cases in the US. In the last 7 days, we had 4.6 million and we're up to 234,000 death. I'm sorry, 834,000 deaths. That's what I get for trying to read the number of new deaths and the total at the same time. You can see, however, that with the rate of mortality, it has slowed, and that is the only silver lining with the number of new cases. And we're going to unpack that a little bit in some of the additional slides that I provide here. So in terms of what the US has been looking at, this is data from September of 2021 through January 1st of 2022, really demonstrating how quickly the Omicron variant became the predominant variant in the United States. November the 27th of 2021, no cases. And then as of December 4th of 2021, you can see almost 8% of cases. And then by the 18th, it was upward of almost 40%. The 25th, we're near 80%. And then by January 1st, we're almost 100% of the cases that were had molecular surveillance. So again, quickly becoming the predominant variant in the United States, and why it's so important that we have this molecular surveillance and are able to do genomic evaluation. It's widespread across the entire United States, so it's not one region of the country or another. And importantly, in the U.S. territories as well. So this is something that the entire continental United States and the rest of the world, frankly, are experiencing. And then we come to the newest media frenzy, which is related to France's IHU variant of concern. And IHU stands simply for the institution that discovered the variant and has not been placed into the WHO's Greek alphabet system yet. But basically, the data about the French IHU variant is that the individual was a French citizen who had been vacationing in Cameroon, had returned from a trip on holiday. The identification of the original variant predates Omicron. So this is really important. So we know that they had our first case of the IHU variant that predated Omicron. Obviously the patient picked it up somewhere while traveling. Thus far, approximately 20 cases have been identified. So this is why the WHO has really said basically that we will monitor this variant, the last point on the slide, but they don't feel that it's a real cause for concern and that all attention should be on Omicron. Now, importantly, why the news media has picked this up and why it's so important to follow closely is that there is a number of mutations. There are 46 total mutations in the spike protein region of this variant. And so it, in terms of mutations, it outpaces Omicron variant. So it's extremely important that we follow this variant closely. But given that it predates Omicron and it is only had 20 cases to date as of 2 days ago when I pulled this information from this slide, it's showing that it's R0 seems to be a much lower number. So in getting those mutations, it may have given up some transmission advantage in its genome. Okay, so that's why variants are important. So let's move on to how the variants impact our clinical presentation for patients. So again, the initial clinical presentation of SARS-CoV-2, our original wild type and the former variants, basically led us down a scenario where a great proportion of people were asymptomatic. Another great proportion of people had mild symptoms. It's hard to say in the epi, it's a good number of people. But then there's a whole group of people that we know who had moderate and severe symptoms. And that was really based on these three conditions: age, race, and comorbidity. And really the data, as it became more and more clear on race, it was a disparity in access and engagement, services and care, comorbidity that was driving this. And the further analysis that unpacked this initially was a lack of access to testing and engagement. Race does not drive COVID-19. It's the social determinants of health and inequities that are driving COVID-19. And so that's a really critical component. But we did know that a good proportion driven by those comorbidities and age went on to develop acute respiratory distress and needed mechanical ventilation, the cytokine storm in which the alveoli was filled with fluid, and lots of immune activation was at play. And there was a really interesting hypothesis about why disparities might exist by race and ethnicity in those who developed severe infection and circulating cytokine levels at baseline. And this really looked at whether or not someone was likely to progress into severe disease based on whether or not they had high or low levels of circulating cytokines of IL-6, IL-8, TNF-alpha, and interleukin-1 beta. And basically, in multiple ones of these circulating cytokines, they showed that if you had a higher level of circulating cytokine at baseline, which is associated oftentimes with chronic stress, it may lead you to worsening disease progression based on the cytokine storm that occurred in patients who had developed acute COVID-19. And of course, this was the seminal JAMA article that showed persistence of COVID-19 symptoms with our original variant that lasted initially from this seminal article of 60 days. And now we're on to patients who are going on for 6 months who continue to have persistent or long COVID symptoms. So when we think about these long COVID symptoms, there have now been 50 long-term effects of COVID-19 identified in a systematic review and meta-analysis. If you hadn't gotten a chance to look at this, I encourage you. But the size of the bubble and its color represents the proportion of people with long COVID symptoms who experienced this phenomenon. And you can see that fatigue and headache continue to be really important symptoms that last for people for a very long time. And the patients I'm speaking to with COVID-19, pre-Omicron and with Omicron, fatigue and headache remain persistent symptoms, even as other symptoms begin to resolve in a large number of people. We're certainly seeing patients who have, COVID brain fog and this feeling of memory loss and difficulty concentrating that remains. And then you can review this list on your own time. You don't have time to go through it all. Now, one differentiating effect is when people come to this process post-vaccine, do the vaccines actually help prevent, even though you might have breakthrough infection, but you might become symptomatic, do the vaccines help prevent long COVID? And that's a really important scientific question that's under investigation right now. Turning our attention to the clinical spectrum of SARS-CoV-2 with Omicron variant, I've hyperlinked the PDF article of the original data that's under preprint review online right now. Again, this has not been peer reviewed at this point. It's undergoing peer review right now, but it shows the South Africa data that helped identify Omicron and its severity. And basically, I'm going to walk you through some of the highlights of that data. First was that symptoms seemed to be milder in general. And this data has been confirmed now in a couple of prospective evaluations. I highlighted here for you the Zoe study. And again, a preprint evaluation, the Zoe data in the cross-sectional data throughout London in particular was comparing periods of when Delta was prevalent versus when Omicron was prevalent. And it gives you the date ranges you can see there. And the initial analysis found that there was no clear difference in early symptoms 3 days within a Delta diagnosis or an Omicron diagnosis. And the top five symptoms, and these are all patient-reported data in on a national evaluation, runny nose, headache, fatigue, sneezing, and sore throat. So, but for the first 3 days, these were consistent across Omicron and Delta. Delta then goes on to develop more severe respiratory and lower respiratory tract symptoms, but Omicron seems to stay kind of in this space. Again, the UK and in London has a high vaccine proportion, whether or not that's virus versus vaccine, having some level of protection from severe illness is still to be determined. In relation to hospitalization, a couple of changes have occurred with Omicron. First of all, age continues to drive hospitalization even amongst vaccinated individuals. Comorbidity is the second form of risk. And in that South Africa study that I've hyperlinked for you up at the top, comorbidity coupled with age were the two driving factors. And then finally, here in the United States and around the world, vaccine status remains another key driver. And you can see data from from New York City at the top of this slide. For every 100 COVID-19 hospitalizations per 100,000 people, you can see this in comparison to the unvaccinated compared to the vaccinated. And what we can see is despite Omicron's impact throughout December, again, the unvaccinated population really driving hospital burden. I wanted to also compare, though, however, to give us the flip side of the coin of this paradox of, is Omicron milder, yes or no? Because this is data from the New York Times comparing the first week of January 1st through the 6th, and of 2021 through the 6th of January, 2022. And what you can see is hospitalizations have risen in DC, New York, and in Chicago. And slowly but surely, increases in ICU stays, as well as increase in mechanical ventilation, has been seen in all three of those cities. Now, what we believe is happening here is that as more and more people get infected and impacted by Omicron, you are driving demand. Obviously, as more and more people get impacted, those in older age and those of longer duration since last vaccination begin to be impacted even greater. So we do anticipate that impact of among the vaccinated community will continue to go up in terms of ICU and ventilator needs. However, it's really being driven in all three of these cities right now by unvaccinated populations of people. So when we say it's milder, is it the vaccine in a highly vaccinated population driving the mildness of Omicron? Because when we look at the unvaccinated population, we are seeing skyrocketing high hospitalizations, full ICUs, as well as increases in mechanical ventilation needs. Now, we've not reached the peak of January of 2021 in terms of ICU and or ventilation needs, but we're on our way. And so finally, with Omicron, we don't yet know. There's no data whatsoever on persistence. And so will it occur? Does it only occur in the unvaccinated population? Does vaccine provide some level of protection? Does it not? It's still an unanswered scientific question. So moving to our vaccines and their efficacy with and booster efficacy with various variants. So we know that based on CDC data for individuals 12 years and up, this was data from a Kaiser Permanente, that people who were unvaccinated were three times more likely to develop infection, two times more likely to be hospitalized, and seven times more likely to die. So first and foremost, vaccine reduces each and every one of these metrics. But when we look here at the really what's driving this, this is all pre-Omicron data for individuals 18 years of age and older. So this is CDC data hot off the presses as of yesterday. These are people who completed a primary COVID-19 vaccination series. So across 465 healthcare facilities. So these are the vaccinated people. And then the question is what really drives severe COVID-19 outcomes in fully vaccinated individuals pre-Omicron? And what you can see, I've highlighted in red, are two boxes, is comorbidity. You can see the comorbidities that don't cross that gray line. So those to the right of the gray line have an increased risk. So basically from diabetes all the way up to immunosuppression. And then what decreases the risk is individuals pre-Omicron who had a previous COVID-19 illness and completed a primary vaccination series, meaning before they were boosted. So what you can see here is that prior COVID-19 illness acted as a booster. So that's what this data is showing us from the CDC. So really, when we think about boosting, originally when the boosters became available, they were in short supply, and all the vaccine manufacturers, the mRNA vaccines here, Pfizer, Moderna, recommended a group of people who should be prioritized to receive them. And you can see the list on each one of these. And the bottom line now is that we want everyone boosted, and the FDA had just approved boosters for those 12 years of age and older as well. And I'm absolutely certain that soon we will be getting boosters for those even younger. But what you can see here is that there are some slight differences. Pfizer has now updated saying that you can get a booster up to 5 months after completion of your primary series. Moderna remains 6 months. We'll talk about J&J in a second. And why that 1 month of savings is so important is, of the patients that I have been diagnosing with Omicron variant and with, you know, COVID-19 over the last several weeks, majority of them were vaccinated, fully vaccinated, but a great proportion of them were not yet in their booster recipient window period. So they were like, yes, I've gotten my vaccine, but they were kind of the hesitant group who got it late and they had not yet been boosted. And so as a result of that, they had a breakthrough infection, pretty symptomatic breakthrough infection. There were two patients that I recommended an emergency department evaluation, but the majority were able to manage their symptoms at home. So knowing that vaccine window of when you can get your booster will be really critical moving forward. Now for J&J, the single dose vaccine, just as a reminder, the J&J second dose could be administered 2 months after the first dose for completion of a booster. So that's really important to know. So if someone got a single dose J&J, 2 months later, they can get a booster dose of J&J, or they can switch completely 2 months later to a separate vaccine with the mRNA vaccines of Moderna or Pfizer. There was also recent data just continued on the mixing and matching of COVID-19 vaccine. And it basically said that if, as long as you've met the window of appropriate boosting, so you've completed your primary series and you're now ready for your booster, if you met the appropriate window, you could mix and match whatever vaccine was available. And so there's even data that suggests when you mix vaccines, so you completed a two-shot Pfizer series and then you boosted with Moderna, for example, that your broadly neutralizing antibodies might even take an extra boost when you switched vaccine between the mRNA vaccines. So recommended boosting, regardless of what booster you get, is extremely important, because we now know with this data that people who had two shots only, so the primary series, but had not yet received a booster, had significantly less protection against Omicron. And that protection wanes significantly over time. But that when you were boosted, and this is data from the director's blog at NIH, you get up to 25 times more protection against Omicron in patients who were recently boosted. Now let's break this apart into a little bit more granular data. Now, this is a lot of studies. This slide is courtesy of the COVID-19 Prevention Network, in which I am a co-investigator participating in through our HIV Prevention Trials Network. So there were, you can see from the figure on the right here, that they were looking at vaccine efficacy of the primary series against Omicron. And you can see that the authors' names are listed to the left. And you can see that vaccine efficacy is listed there at the bottom. Vaccine efficacy, 0, 10%, 20%, 30%. And it's color-coded for you. So the Colley et al. Trial showed that the hospitalization efficacy of the Pfizer vaccine was between 50 and 60%. For infection, there were two studies that looked at Moderna, one that showed COVID-19 with Omicron had, with a Moderna vaccine, had really no efficacy of preventing infection. You can see that an additional study, a wide confidence interval there by Ouellette et al. For both Pfizer, Moderna, as well as AstraZeneca. And that another study by Ferguson looked at the Pfizer vaccine and showed that its vaccine efficacy fell to around 20%. You can see down below in the bottom figure there is that with booster dosing against Omicron, you can see that that vaccine effectiveness went back up into the 50, 60, 70% range, but was not as high as those early estimates with prior variants of the 90%+ range. You can see that for hospitalization, the evaluation of Pfizer, Moderna, and AstraZeneca was really great, really strong. Across those various arms for hospitalization, but much lower for all three of those vaccines in relation to disease, broken apart by those 50 years of age and older, which had lower efficacy compared to those 49 and younger. So again, we're learning more and more about vaccine efficacy against Omicron, which is why we see such rampant cases. Omicron as a variant is has learned to impact our vaccination status. So really, if you've been fully vaccinated with two series vaccine, but not yet boosted, you're at great risk of infection for the Omicron variant. If you've been recently boosted, you have a much better chance of protection against infection, as you can see from this bottom slide, of about 70 to 80%, 60 to 80% rather. But as that booster has waned and you've longer and longer since your booster, then that efficacy is beginning to appear to wane quite quickly. So, and this slide presents the duration of infection. The duration of protection since you've received the primary series in the top left of against infection. You can see that about 20 weeks, vaccine effectiveness is virtually almost zero across multiple vaccines. There's one study that shows in the dotted line there that it's around 20%, but in multiple studies by about 20 weeks, if you've only received the primary vaccinations with Omicron, it is basically as if you've not been vaccinated. Hospitalization went from around 70 plus percent vaccination at week 10 down to around 50% protection if you've not been boosted by week 40. And then again, against disease, so not just infection, but symptomatology, look at almost all the vaccines by week 20 have 0% effectiveness if infection occurs against disease. Note that you flip to the bottom right, and it's a complicated slide using multiple studies and multiple vaccines, but with boosting, that all rises again from that 0% with boosting back into the range of about 55 to 80% at week one. And you can see that that tails off and begins to fall across multiple different vaccines. And that by week 10 to 12, you're getting down to around 40% efficacy again. So now what's come out in the news media is that Pfizer's CEO says that an Omicron vaccine will be ready in March. So for those of you who think I'm fully boosted, I've gotten my both series and boosting, get ready because it's likely that other variant-specific vaccines will be on the horizon. I'm not sure, and we can debate whether or not this is the accurate approach. It seems like we need to get ahead and not continually responding to various vaccines, because that means we're going to be vaccinated every quarter from here forward if we don't play our cards right. So there's a lot to debate here, but additional vaccinations are on the horizon. Moving on into how the Omicron variant has impacted treatment recommendations. These guidelines were just updated this morning on the NIH website, so I encourage you to take a look at those. And basically, the guidelines recommend a variety of different therapies for non-hospitalized individuals as well as hospitalized individuals. And then they break them down based on symptom burden and disease severity in the hospitalized individual and about whether or not you've been hospitalized or not in the non-hospitalized individual. I think that while the committees have done an excellent job of trying to break this down into a discernible way, I find the image here on this next slide a lot more digestible. So this is a great schematic that has been designed that kind of helps break down patients in these guidelines into real-world implementation. So the first is that you can identify settings. So before the hospital, in outpatients, in the viral phase, obviously monoclonal antibodies and convalescent plasma remain hallmarks of treatment. Now, this slide is a slightly older version, and I'm going to show you a newer version of the oral meds that the guidelines currently today recommend as outpatient. But I wanted to begin here because it's just a great schematic of where treatment paradigms sit today. Once a person comes into the hospital, they divide whether or not someone's requiring oxygen or not, and whether or not they require intensive care or not. And really, our guidelines fit within, for requiring oxygen, you use remdesivir, potentially convalescent plasma, and then the addition of corticosteroids. For those who require mechanical ventilation, you know, that anti-inflammatory response is the quintessential mainstay of therapy, the corticosteroids and the broadly neutralizing antibody therapy is what's recommended. Now, we have made a lot of progress on the treatment options that are available for outpatients pre-admission, and I wanted to go through those. So as I mentioned before, Omicron has obliterated two of our monoclonal antibodies. Right now we're left with sotrovimab, which has an 85% efficacy. Its relative risk reduction is 85%. It is available in IV infusion in one single dose. And at JHU, at Johns Hopkins, it is limited with an application by the prescriber. So it is tightly controlled. There's a series of guidelines that we must meet in order to provide this drug. Its pros is that it is highly effective, and there are few drug-drug interactions, so it can be used with much other agents. However, it's limited availability. It is not broadly available to most patients. It is an IV infusion, and a nurse must observe the patient for a one-hour period after its administration. The Paxlovid, which is a combination of nirmatrelvir, plus ritonavir, which is a pharmacologic enhancer that we've used in HIV for decades now, has an 88% efficacy. It is the DHHS preferred regimen for current pre-hospital admission symptom management. It is in very limited supply in Maryland. I spent an hour and a half on the phone the other day trying to get one of my patients with HIV who was really symptomatic, but refusing to go to the emergency department this drug and was unsuccessful. The pharmacist basically said, try in the next week or so, which of course, with a drug that only can be started within 5 days of symptom onset, next week doesn't work. The pros, it's a highly effective medication. It is an all-oral regimen. Its cons is there's no current availability, at least in the multiple pharmacies, including the Johns Hopkins outpatient pharmacies that I called, as well as Walgreens and CVS. It is a 3-pill twice a day regimen, which some patients will find challenging. And those ritonavir in particular causes nausea and diarrhea that patients will find challenging. It must start within 5 days of illness onset, and there are many drug-drug interactions, many. And a prescriber must check the patient's drugs to make sure that there will not be a drug-drug interaction. Molnupiravir has about a 30% efficacy for the patient I was just describing who is highly symptomatic, living with HIV, and was refusing to go to the emergency department. I was ultimately able to get her this drug. It is an 800 milligram twice daily regimen. Again, it's taken for 5 days. Was available at a Walgreens. Once you call a Walgreens pharmacy, there is a single Walgreens handling all COVID-19 therapeutics for the city of Baltimore. And you must find that Walgreens and call them. It was a 45-minute hold time for the prescriber line at this particular Walgreens. The pro is that it's more likely to be available right now as an all-oral regimen. It has low efficacy, as you can see, 30% relative risk reduction, and you must start again within 5 days of illness onset. Finally, remdesivir has an 87% risk reduction. It is a 200 milligram IV infusion on day one, followed by 100 milligrams on day two and three, but the DHHS guidelines list it to be used as its second regimen of choice as outpatient IV therapy. I don't know about you, but most clinics aren't equipped in outpatient environments. Number one, don't have access to the drug, but number two, giving IV therapy in most primary care clinics is not the norm. So it is highly effective. It has been studied in pregnancy, and there are few to no drug-drug interactions. So all good pros. The cons of which is poor availability, and there's challenging, obviously, implementation. I did want to note that this week, the drugs listed below, the broadly neutralizing antibodies, TICs and silgavimab, are recently approved by the FDA for pre-exposure prophylaxis in high-risk individuals. And there is some preliminary in vitro data only that it is effective for Omicron. So again, a good sign about potential for pre-exposure prophylaxis in patients who have been exposed but not yet tested positive for Omicron. So I want to end us here, and I see there's some questions popping up in the chat, and I'm looking forward to answering those. What is the new normal for 2022 and beyond? So there is a great article published in JAMA, an opinion piece over the last several days by Dr. Emmanuel and colleagues, Dr. Celine Gounder, who many of you may know as a CNN correspondent, did her ID fellowship here at Johns Hopkins. So she's a great colleague. And really worked and has done a lot of thinking around what is our new public health practices going to be with Omicron. And so I found some really important vignettes out of this article that I wanted to share with you. The authors note that policymakers, and I would go take that beyond, so those quotations are my own additions. I would say policymakers, public health officials, physicians, and nurses need to specify the goals and strategies for our new normal and communicate this clearly to the public. The new normal in January of 2022 is not living without COVID-19. It does not include eradication or elimination in the foreseeable future. The national and personal risk must be developed. We need a new definition of what it means to be at risk as a nation, at our local level, and at our personal level. I, as a fully boosted individual, fully dosed and fully boosted individual, do not carry the same risk as a fully dosed and fully boosted individual who's 75 years of age. And do all levels of public health practices need to apply to all people equally? I think it's something we have to continue to grapple with. They go on to propose a peak week risk threshold. And what they mean by this is we know that there's a variety of circulating viruses, flu, RSV, and COVID-19, all at the same time. We know that based on mortality and hospitalization that our rates are increasing, but at what level within the vaccinated population is our risk threshold? So right now it appears that compared to people 60 years of age and older with pandemic, with seasonal influenza, we have reached a threshold for COVID-19 that we're actually lower than general national morbidity mortality against seasonal influenza, depending on your year you evaluate this. And so they're articulating a question which says, at what threshold are we willing to accept our new normal in vaccinated individuals when we are now below what we would routinely see as seasonal influenza morbidity mortality? And they call for rebuilding public health infrastructure. They suggest a digital, real-time, data-driven infrastructure. They call for increased public health workforces, and with a specific emphasis noted in the article on school nurse programs as part of that public health nurse workforce. And they call for continuing the removal of practice barriers. They don't specifically mention scope of practice per se, but they call for several items: institutionalizing telemedicine waivers and licensure to practice and enable billing across state lines, and other measures that allow us to flow medical services to severely affected regions, they note should be a priority. I think that's a great recommendation. So I'm now gonna turn it over, stop sharing the slides, and see if we can get to the chat and any other conversations and discussions people might have as we wrap up the session. Okay, so let's see. So the first question comes from Bernadette Walters. So is there a way to have a diagnosis of COVID-19 illness after the two vaccinations listed on a vaccination card, since it is shown to act as a booster after the primary vaccination series? That's an interesting question, Bernadette. I don't think at this point COVID-19 infection, because we originally thought COVID-19 infection with a Delta variant or other variant would lead to significant protection, right? But with Omicron, we saw that it actually prior infection does not provide that same level of boosting. So it most likely has to do with timing. So even our boosters, once we see that date begin to go on to 10, 15, 20 weeks post-booster will no longer be overly protective. So I'm not sure that the COVID-19 illness documentation would provide any more data than a COVID booster, but it certainly does offer you a three-month window before you should receive a follow-up booster. So it could be something that you might want to talk to your primary care provider about. If one had an infection with Omicron, do they need to be vaccinated with the vaccine, or will they body develop a natural immunity? Well, this is a great, great question. So just like with prior COVID infections, we saw that prior infection led to some level of broadly neutralizing antibody, and that provided some level of protection over a period of time. But in multiple variants, so take the case of Manaus, Brazil, for example, the population was seen to have a high penetrance of alpha and beta variants in Manaus. And when the Delta variant came along, it basically showed us that prior infection with alpha and beta was not protective against Delta variant. And so again, there was some period of time that elapsed, so it's likely waning immunity over time, but also because of the mutations that occur with each of the variants, it's unlikely that we will get the perfect prior infection that leads us to this holy grail of long-lasting immunity, because we're just not seeing it in this particular circumstance. Let's see. Every seen by a doctor to be given any of these drugs? Do you have to be seen by a doctor to be given any of these drugs? I think Dr. Cargill actually answered that question. Yes, they required that they're given by the route of administration, potential side effects, you have to be evaluated. I agree with Dr. Cargill's response there. And yes, none of these drugs are available over the counter. They require a prescription. And importantly, the majority of them have a time window. So once you become symptomatic, again, it's really critical that you seek treatment as early as possible, because once 5 days post-symptom onset has occurred, you're basically out of luck with regards to us being able to use these drugs effectively. Dr. Dorcas has asked me to please address CDC guidelines for isolation and quarantine. Okay, well, I was trying to avoid that landmine. So CDC guidelines shifted dramatically. And as many of you may know, if you're paying attention to CNN today, Dr. Fauci and Dr. Walensky are both on the Hill being grilled by the Senate committee about all of these decisions. So if you've listened to Dr. Fauci and to Dr. Walensky defend the decision the CDC made, it is about that risk mitigation, risk balance approach that the authors of the JAMA article were really talking about. How do we think about what our new normal will be under a highly vaccinated population scenario? And, you know, the bottom line is that we know after symptom onset and after symptom defervescence or symptoms begin to decline, that the likelihood of transmission drops significantly after about 5 days, as long as symptoms are resolving. If you're 5 days into your illness and you're still very symptomatic, febrile, have a fever, coughing your head off, you know, all your symptoms are still present, your 5 days have not begun. So remember, the initial five days of quarantine at home really begins after symptoms begin to resolve and you no longer have fever for 24 hours. So they've clarified that just a little bit, that it's about symptom resolution. But moving on to that second 5 days, I've had so many conversations with people who have no idea how to interpret, okay, well, my symptoms have resolved, I'm now in the 5 day period, but they've now told me I need to mask. So the number of people who have quarantined their loved one in the basement or sent them to their, you know, to a separate, you know, hotel room or a house in Rehoboth in one scenario, you know, who literally separated themselves because of that 5 day 100% masking. People are really trying to implement that and trying to avoid, you know, family members who didn't become infected with Omicron. Now with Delta and other prior variants, I will say that there were many households because of our household study in which we tested where there was a positive individual in the household, and despite interaction in the household, other household members, not everyone became infected with Delta. Now with Omicron, we're seeing entire households get infected with this variant. So, and that's a big difference in terms of, again, going back to that transmissibility that we're seeing. So in terms of what happens at the second 5 days of wearing your mask and no longer needing to quarantine, the reason the CDC made that recommendation is because they knew you were less likely to transmit. They knew you were wearing a mask in all circumstances and settings. And if that were the possibility, and that were the case, you could return to work or to whatever the next event would be for you. I have, however, tried to implement that policy with a couple of people whose workplace said, no, until you get a negative RNA test, a negative PCR, you're unable to come back to work. And I tried to inform both the patients so they could inform their workplace that that's not the way to go, right? A PCR test will remain positive for weeks, if not potentially months in some patients, despite having no replication capacity, no ability of that virus to transmit to other people. So I think that's really important for us to know is that, you know, you going back and once your symptoms are resolving, retesting as a metric to return to work with a PCR test is not the right approach. Okay, Dr. Towson says, is there a vitamin supplement regimen to prevent COVID-19 Omicron? The number of patients who've asked me that, oh my goodness, I've had a lot of them. You know, the data is inconclusive. There are some that say that zinc, high dose zinc, or high dose vitamin C might help with symptom burden, but there's no clinical evidence, clinical trial evidence that suggests that there will be improvements. So for patients who don't need an antiviral, because they're either out of the 5 days and yet they still have symptoms or they don't want to take an antiviral, I'm managing by symptom burden. So if they have fevers, then we'll manage with an appropriate NSAID or Tylenol based on their disease approach. I will recommend a multivitamin that's high in zinc if they feel like they want to do something that might help with high in vitamin C. Again, just as an abundance of caution, but there's no really strong data that says that helps with symptom improvement. Dr. Cargill says, Dr. Emanuel gave a rather concerning statement this morning on CNN about masking, implies that KN95s and KN94 masks are useless without specifying talking about counterfeit. Worried that this message can be misconstrued. So counterfeit masks have been a problem, as Dr. Cargill well knows. I work in tuberculosis, and counterfeit masks have been a problem forever in our TB space. They're always an issue. And so knowing where your N95 comes from and looking at the NIOSH website, the National Institute of Occupational Safety and Health, and whether or not it is an approved vendor and approved mask that's listed on their N95 or N94, KN94 or FFP2, there's a whole series of abbreviations that if you can't find an N95 that you can use on that website, will help you determine whether or not you're ordering from maybe a vendor who is overseas and it is actually labeled an N95, but not really an N95. We've seen that in TB for decades now. And I'm sure we're seeing it with COVID. How many days after being exposed or thinking you're exposed might you become positive? So the incubation period for COVID-19 on average, you know, the CDC will say 2 to 14 days after exposure, you might develop symptoms, but it's around 5 to 6 days. So I don't test my patients who come to me saying they've been exposed until day 5 or later, or if symptoms begin earlier than day 5, I will test. Again, because of that, average incubation period is what I'm using to determine whether or not they need a test. If you have a severe reaction like reported to Pfizer to the second vaccine, would a booster be expected to cause the same reaction? It certainly can. It can even get worse. So if you have a severe reaction, I would talk to your healthcare provider. I would make sure they were aware of what that severe reaction was. Make sure they can document it as an allergy to the vaccine. And then they would give you recommendations on the best approach forward. It would, depending on if they determined it was a true allergy to the vaccine, then they may recommend against boosting. Particularly, they may recommend against boosting with that particular dose or drug. They could also recommend having access to additional therapies on hand in case you became symptomatic. So there are a variety of different approaches they might take, but severe reactions are not to be taken lightly because you could develop an acute anaphylaxis if you were to get a booster dose and your true second dose primed you for that reaction. Let's see, Erica asked, what about asymptomatic persons that we were once told you could transmit spread? You can still transmit spread. You can transmit spread. Absolutely. Everyone who's asymptomatic, if you test positive, even without symptoms, you can absolutely transmit and spread. If you don't even get tested and you think you were exposed and you stay asymptomatic, you could be theoretically transmitting and spreading. Absolutely. Let's see, Troy, if COVID does get upgraded from pandemic to endemic, have any studies shown how many times we will need to be vaccinated yearly? No, not to my knowledge. Is there a possibility that the current epi data on Omicron is biased? Some people with really mild symptoms do not report to the hospital and researchers. It will let us underestimate the severity and threat of Omicron in terms of spreading. Well, I think it's absolutely possible that we're seeing the tip of the iceberg. A variety of people are not presenting at all. People are, you know, in our random household survey called C-Forward, Community Collaboration to Combat COVID-19, we have been randomly assessing households throughout the entire pandemic and evaluating whether or not they developed any both PCR or antibody status in each of those households. During the most recent recruitments in December into January, in randomly selected households, we've identified at least 10 who actively were PCR positive at the time in which they were randomly selected for participation. And that's just astronomical when you think about it, because a household that's randomly selected to participate in a study and agrees to participate certainly should be at relatively low population risk of having COVID-19. And it just shows us just how ubiquitous this is in our community. Let's see, can you speak to the current state of research treatment for pediatric cases of multiple inflammatory syndrome? I have to admit, being an adult nurse practitioner, and I have not focused highly on the pediatric literature. It is certainly a concern and alarming. I know that I saw some pediatric colleagues on the Zoom list here today who might be able to speak to that. And I'm certainly happy to open it to the floor if anyone knows better, but I would prefer to defer that because I have not paid a close attention to that literature. Let's see, last question. I think my other part to my question was, how many days after possibly being positive can you receive treatment or therapy? If you are based on your symptom onset, so if your symptoms begin and you test the day your symptoms begin, you have 5 days. If your symptoms began 4 days ago and you go get tested today, you have 1 day left that I can still give you those medicines in which 5 days from the symptom onset began. Remember, it's 5 days from symptom onset, not 5 days from your positive COVID test. So really, you want to get tested as soon as you become symptomatic and not waiting, because 5 days from the onset of symptoms is what we are going by for prescription of both Paxlovid and Molnupiravir. Yes, Ingrid, some people have decided to not wear a mask in the face of easier transmission of COVID-19. What are your suggestions for them and the pediatric population? So the notion of fatalism, I might as well just get it and get it over with, is what Ingrid is describing. And we've seen that in multiple different chronic infections, HIV in particular. We call that fatalism. It's just so ubiquitous. I just need to go ahead and get it over with. And we've seen that kind of approach with COVID-19. I would say that is a very individualistic mindset because of the transmissibility of this virus. Getting it and getting it over with, it allows it to propagate into the others in which you're being exposed. And you know, once you expose yourself to it and you don't know when you become infected and are potentially exposing more vulnerable people, you don't know in which you become viremic and start to transmit, which can be days before your symptoms onset. You don't know how long you will remain positive and whether or not long COVID symptoms will develop, because we can't tell you the answer to that. So the get it and get it over with, I find, is a stupid philosophy and should not be implemented as any form of personal or protection or any other form of let's just get back to normal. In terms of pediatrics, again, the school system is in quite a mess. Many school systems both re-shutting down, going back virtual, including Johns Hopkins School of Nursing, to try to mitigate the spread of this. I would just say that when at all possible, we got to start thinking about our local epidemiology, local school systems. It can't be a one-stop shop for all schools at all places at all times, I don't think, any longer. Now that we can vaccinate those 5 years of age and older, we need to focus on vaccine and when available, boosting of that population. And then ultimately trying to take a local community and potentially even local school district determination of how our young learners can get back into the classroom, because we know the deleterious effects on them and their mental health and their socialization are clearly important as well. So with that, I tried to get through all the questions. Just great audience, great questions. I really appreciate your engagement here. And I hope that this was helpful to understand where we are as we begin year 3 of COVID-19. Thanks, everyone.